Hi everyone, this is Kalyan Kumar and welcome to Chemistry Tutorials. We have just completed the lesson General Organic Chemistry, which was a 13-part series. And now I've decided to switch gears and do a lesson from Physical Chemistry. This is a lesson generally taught in grade 11 and this is titled Gaseous State. And this is also a 13-part series. And this video is part one of that. This is titled Basic Definitions, Barometer and Manometer. Now generally when this lesson is taught, there are only very basic things that are generally taught, whereas I am going to go a little more in-depth into this lesson so that if you're preparing for, let's say, an entrance exam like IIT JEE or maybe you are preparing for AP Chemistry, you will find this set of videos really very useful. So let's start with part 1 of 13 basic definitions, barometer and manometer. Now, when we did organic chemistry, we saw the theory completely first. And once the theory was done, then we looked into certain questions. The physical chemistry is going to happen in a slightly different way. I'm going to teach you a particular concept, and after that concept, we are going to do a couple of examples in knowing how to apply these concepts in real questions. And therefore, what you would need to do is once I give an example, a question, you should pause the video, do the question on your own and then play the video back to understand whether you have learned that particular concept properly or not. So let's jump into the part one of gaseous state. Now there are two types of tendencies that define the physical state of a compound: the intermolecular forces and molecular motion. Now intermolecular forces, as the name itself suggests, is the force that holds the molecules together. Whereas molecular motion is representative of how weak the forces are, because weaker the forces, more randomly the molecules or the atoms are going to move. So it is these two factors which will determine the final state of a particular substance. The forces of attraction between polar molecules is called dipole-dipole forces. The forces of attraction between non-polar molecules is called dispersion force or induced dipole force, or you can even call it van der Waals force. Molecules also possess thermal energy which is directly related to temperature. This energy tends to make the molecules move in random motion, giving them the freedom to occupy more space. It is the balance of the attractive forces and the molecular tendencies to move that defines the three states of matter. So as I said before, it is the dominating force among intermolecular force or the motion of the molecule which will finally determine in which particular state, physical state, will this particular compound end up with. So, and molecular motion is a function of temperature. More the temperature, more is the randomized molecular motion. So let's look at how these forces work for the three different states of matter. Now the first one we talk about are the solids. Now, if the attractive forces dominate over the thermal motion of molecules, it will result in a solid. And this definitely makes sense. If the force of attraction that holds the molecules together is greater than the tendency to move, it implies that that particular thing is going to be a solid. They are rigid and incompressible. They have fixed shape and volume. They have their melting and boiling points above room temperature. And they have high density. Now, the fact that they are solids at room temperature definitely implies that their melting and boiling points both are above room temperature. So that is why they are right now solid, because if the melting point were lower than the room temperature, it would have been a liquid. So their melting and boiling points are above the room temperature. They are highly dense because the amount of volume they occupy is low because of greater molecular interaction compared to molecular motion. Liquids. Now, if the thermal motion increases and there is a balance between attractive and molecular motion, it results in a liquid. So liquid is sort of a balance of the strong molecular forces and the ability to move, the tendency to move. If these two are sort of balancing each other, it would result in a liquid. They are less rigid than solids and less incompressible. They don't have fixed shape, but do have fixed volume, and their melting point are below room temperature, but boiling is above. So the very fact that they are existing as liquid implies that their melting points are lower than the room temperature and the boiling points are higher. Now compared to solids, you can definitely compress them more than the solids themselves. The application of pressure does not create a greater change in the volume of a solid as it does in the case of a liquid. And finally, the density is definitely lower than solids, greater volume. And now we talk about gases. Now in the case of gases, if the molecular motion is much greater than the force of attraction, the result is a gas. The ability to move is far greater than the force of attraction that holds the molecules together. So they will start moving randomly and they will exist in the form of a gas. If molecular motion is higher than the attractive force, it results in a gas. They are highly compressible, don't have any fixed shape or volume. They occupy the entire container. They have melting and boiling points much below room temperature. They have much lower density compared to even liquids. And they have the tendency to diffuse from a region of high to a region of low pressure. So the gas is the one which results because of greater molecular motion as compared to force of attraction. It has a much lower density because the volume occupied is pretty high. In fact, they don't even have a fixed volume. Whatever container in which you keep them, they will occupy the entire container. And another important feature about gases is the fact that they can diffuse from a region of high pressure to a region of low pressure. So now let's look at some measurable parameters of a gas. First, now these are the parameters which will represent a gas. So if you want to understand a gas, you want to understand at what state it is, you want to understand its behavior, you need to have certain basic parameters based on which you can arrive at that particular conclusion. And these are amount of a gas, which is measured either in mass, gram or number of mole, the volume of a gas, generally it is the volume of the container in which the gas is kept, and the volume can be measured in various units like liter, centimeter cube, meter cube, decimeter cube, milliliter, cc, etc. And the conversion factors are 1 liter is 1000 milliliter or 1000 centimeter cube or 1000 cc. So milliliter, centimeter cube, cc, they are all same. And 1 liter is also 1 decimeter cube or 10 to the power negative 3 meter cube. The next thing that we need to know about a gas is the temperature. The temperature is the reflection of the heat content or the thermal energy of a gas. Now what this means is that whatever heat content the gas has, that is reflected in its temperature. Higher temperature means more energy, lesser temperature means the gas has less energy. So it is the heat content or the energy content of the gas which is measured in terms of temperature. Temperature can be measured in any of the units, degree Celsius, Fahrenheit and Kelvin. And the temperature in Kelvin is measured as temperature in degree Celsius plus 273. And temperature in degree Celsius can be converted to Fahrenheit using this particular equation, 5 over 9 T degree Fahrenheit minus 32. The next thing that we need to understand is the pressure of a gas. It is the force exerted per unit area by a gas on all the walls of the container, which is defined as the pressure. And you can measure it as atmosphere, in bar, in torr, in millimeter of Hg, centimeter of Hg, Pascal, etc. And this is the conversion factor of 1 atmosphere is 1.01325 bar or 1.01325 into 10 to the power 5 Newton per meter square. And remember, Newton per meter square is also Pascal. You can also say that 1 atmosphere is 760 millimeter of Hg, 76 centimeter of Hg, 0.76 meters of Hg or 760 torr. Now this term 760 mm of Hg basically means that whatever is the pressure exerted by the atmospheric gases at sea level is same as the pressure which a mercury column of 760 millimeters or 76 centimeter or 0.76 meter would exert at the bottom. So whenever we want to talk about atmospheric pressure, we can talk about the pressure in terms of the mercury column. and generally one atmosphere, which is assumed to be the pressure of the atmosphere, is equal to 760 millimeters of Hg, meaning the pressure exerted by the mercury column of 760 millimeters is equal to the pressure exerted by the gases in the atmosphere. Alright, now let's talk about the pressure measuring devices. Now, in the pressure measuring devices, there are two devices that we are going to talk about in this video. One is called the barometer and the other is called the manometer. Now, barometer is a device used to measure the pressure of the atmospheric gases. So, whatever is the pressure exerted by the atmosphere, that is the pressure which we need to measure using a barometer. Whereas a manometer is a device which will measure the pressure of a given amount of gas. So, if we have a certain amount of gas in a container, you want to know what pressure it is, we use a manometer to find that out. So, let's understand how does a barometer work and how does a manometer work. First, the barometer. As I said, a barometer is an instrument that is used for the measurement of atmospheric pressure. The pressure exerted by atmosphere on Earth's surface at sea level is called atmospheric pressure. A thin, narrow, calibrated capillary tube is filled with mercury up to the brim. Now, we have a very thin capillary tube, though I'm going to show you a thicker tube to make you understand, but it's a very thin capillary tube and it has readings marked on it. So, you can read the mercury level by looking at those marks. And we fill it up to the brim with liquid mercury. So, this is the capillary tube. And as you can see, it's getting filled up with mercury. Filled up to the brim. Right now, I'm not showing the meniscus shape. It is then inverted into a trough filled with mercury. So, I have a beaker, a trough, a vessel which contains liquid mercury. And I invert this tube into that. Now, depending on the atmospheric pressure, the level of mercury in the capillary tube will adjust itself. Now, remember, there is one particular law that we're going to use here, and that is that if two particles are at the same level, the pressure both experience is equal. Whether they are inside a tube, outside a tube, wherever they may be, if they are at the same level in terms of height, then they must be experiencing the same amount of pressure. So, depending on the atmospheric pressure that the atmosphere is exerting on the surface of mercury in the trough, the mercury column inside will adjust so that whatever particles are on the same height will experience the same amount of pressure. And since you've already filled up the capillary tube up to the brim, slowly the mercury in the capillary tube will start falling down and will stop when the pressure exerted at the surface inside the tube and outside the tube are equal. Let me explain. So, just have a look at this. This is the mercury. Just see, it's going to start falling. And it stops. Now, how does it stop, or why does it stop, and when does it stop? The pressure exerted here on the surface, if you just look at this particular thing, all particles in this level have the same height with respect to the ground. So, what will happen is, any particle here will experience the same pressure as it is here. So, the mercury column, now here the particle is experiencing the pressure of the mercury column. Whereas here the particle is experiencing the pressure due to atmosphere. If they are same in pressure, then the mercury level will adjust itself so that it will be able to balance the pressure of the atmosphere here. So, whatever is the pressure exerted by the atmosphere on this particle has to be same as that of the mercury column on this particle. So, this column will adjust itself. So, this is vacuum, because earlier it was mercury, now the mercury has gone down, so it will be vacuum. The pressure experienced by the particles of mercury at the same level will be equal. So, this is the atmospheric pressure. And the inside pressure is the pressure due to the h height of mercury. So, I'm assuming this is h. So, the pressure exerted by this height of mercury column here would be equal to the atmospheric pressure, because these two particles are at the same level. So all I have to do is read this H and I'll be able to figure out the pressure. So now let's figure out an expression for pressure in terms of height. Now please understand, when I'm talking about this lesson, I'm assuming there's a student of grade 11. And there were some of the very basic concepts, like how is the pressure measured, or what are the units and conversion methods. I'm going to talk about them. But if you're already in an advanced level, you may ignore these. But the fact is, it is better to, you know, learn all of them in one go anyway, even if you know about them. But I'm presuming this is a student of grade 11, and therefore I'm going to talk about even those basic principles. So, therefore, the pressure exerted by the mercury column on the surface of the trough will be equal to the atmospheric pressure. Now, we know that pressure is force upon area. And force is mass into the gravitational attraction. So, the pressure exerted by the mercury column, H height of mercury column, on the surface, at the same level as that of the trough, is going to be the total force exerted by the mercury column upon the area of the surface. Now, the force exerted by the mercury column will be equal to mass of that mercury column into G. So, pressure becomes mg by A. And now I'm going to change the mass as volume into density. Mass is volume into density. And then volume I'm going to expand as area into height. So area gets cancelled. The A gets cancelled here. So we are left with pressure equal to H rho g. So remember, pressure exerted by a liquid of height H is H rho g. H is the height, rho is the density, g is acceleration due to gravity. We can take it as 9.8 meter per second square. So pressure is H rho g. Remember, this is the most basic formula that you need to remember always. Now we talk about manometer. And there are two of them. One is called open end manometer. Now, open end manometer. Manometer, as I said, is a device to measure the pressure of a given amount of gas. Now, if the pressure of the gas is very close to the atmospheric pressure, by close it could be either a little less or a little bit more. And closer it is to the atmospheric pressure, easier it will be for us to use a manometer. If it is too far different, then you cannot use an open end manometer, you will have to use a close end manometer. And there is no cutoff limit beyond which you can use a manometer, open end or close end. The closer it is to one, better is the working of open end manometer, lesser will be the error, easier it will be for us to physically use it. And closed end manometer is used when the pressure of the gas is much, much lower or much, much higher than the atmospheric pressure. Now, this is a device to measure the pressure of a given amount of gas whose pressure is comparable to or higher than the atmospheric pressure. And this is the device, and as it is called open end, this part, as you notice, is open. And this is where the gas resides. So it consists of a U-tube connected to a vessel containing the gas, and the other limb that is longer is open at the top. The U-tube is partially filled with mercury. So we partially fill this with mercury, and this is the mercury being filled up. Now, if the mercury are at the same level, it would imply that the pressure exerted here and the pressure exerted here are equal. Because remember, if a pressure exerted is more on one side and less on the other side, then they cannot be at the same level. If they are at the same level, then both are experiencing the same amount of force, because both will experience the same amount of gravitational pull. So both are going to be attracted by gravity by the same amount. But the fact is, the one with a higher pressure will be lower, the one with a lower pressure will be higher, and if they are at the same level, they must be experiencing the same amount of pressure. Now, the mercury column at the open end is experiencing atmospheric pressure, whereas the mercury column that is attached to the vessel is experiencing the pressure of the gas. And if they are at the same level, it means the pressure of the gas is equal to that of the atmosphere. So the mercury at the open end experiences atmospheric pressure. This is atmospheric pressure. The mercury at the other end of the U-tube experiences the pressure exerted by the gas. This is the gas pressure. If the mercury level at both ends is same, then the pressure exerted by the gas must be equal to the atmospheric pressure. On the other hand, if the mercury level at the gas is lower, then the gas must be exerting more pressure than the atmospheric pressure. So, if it is like this, and the gas pressure is greater, so that end will be lower, this is lower, as you can see this is higher. So, we get this difference in height, and this is the height h. So, this means now at this level, at the bottom level, both the particle here and the particle here are experiencing the same pressure. So, this is gas pressure, whereas the particle that is experiencing the pressure here is 1 atmosphere plus the pressure of this h, which is h rho g. So, pressure of the gas here is equal to the atmospheric pressure plus h rho g. Now, on the other hand, if the mercury level at the gas end is higher than the level at the open end, then the pressure of the gas will be lower. So, for example, if you have something like this, then obviously the pressure exerted here is atmospheric pressure, and the pressure exerted at this level must be equal. So, the pressure here must be equal to 1 atmosphere or the atmospheric pressure, and that is equal to the pressure of the gas plus h rho g. So, pressure of atmosphere is pressure of gas plus h rho g. So, pressure of gas should be equal to atmospheric pressure minus h rho g. Now, let's talk about the close end manometer, which is meant for pressures which are much lower than the atmospheric pressure. So, this is a device to measure the pressure of a given amount of gas whose pressure is much lower, or for that matter much higher. It consists of the closed end. It is just similar to the open end manometer. It is closed here, and it consists of a U-tube with one of the limb connected to the vessel and the other closed and filled with mercury. And this is how it is. Now, the part of the tube which is vacant, this is vacuum. There is no gas here, remember. We have evacuated this. So, it's vacuum. Now, obviously, going by the same logic, the pressure here is the pressure of the gas. Okay? So, now, pressure of gas here, for example, in this case, this is higher, right? This is higher pressure, this is lower pressure. Now, what is the pressure here? The pressure here, the pressure at this point is h rho g. Remember, there is no atmosphere here, it's vacuum. So, the pressure here is h rho g. So, and since the pressure here and here are same, and the pressure here is that of gas, so the pressure of gas will be h rho g. H rho g. So, that is how a barometer and a manometer work. So, now let's do a couple of questions, numerical questions, some theoretical questions to understand the applications of these better. The first question is, why is mercury used in the barometer tube? Now, the reason mercury is used, one of the reasons why mercury is used in a barometer is the fact that it doesn't stick to the wall, and the fact that it's metallic, so it can be easily seen outside the glass, and you'll be able to figure out its level. Reading will be easier. Since it's a metal, it'll be easily able to absorb heat from the surrounding and reach thermal equilibrium with the surrounding. You don't want the mercury inside to be at a different temperature than the temperature outside. So, it'll reach thermal equilibrium very quickly. So, you don't have to wait for the liquid to absorb heat and then allow it to expand and use for the final pressure after allowing it to expand. Here, all expansion, everything will happen immediately. And the fact that it is having a high density, its density around 13.6 gram per cc, the level, the height required to measure the atmospheric pressure will be reasonable. So, remember, pressure is h rho g. So, atmospheric pressure is fixed. So, h rho g has to be equal to 1 atmosphere in a barometer tube. If rho is higher, h would be smaller. Smaller enough to use the barometer. But if you use something like water, which has just 1 gram per cc, The row being very small, the height required will be so high that you might not even find it comfortable to use a barometer of that bigger length. So the bulkiness of the barometer will increase if you use liquids of low density. So as I mentioned, mercury doesn't stick to the wall. Mercury being non-volatile will not evaporate, and therefore the pressure of its vapor need not be taken into account. Now this is a very important point. If you look at the barometer, you have the mercury inside the barometer, inside the capillary, and above the mercury you have vacuum. But if it were a volatile liquid meaning liquid that can evaporate easily. So if it were a volatile liquid, then the vapors of mercury will also occupy the space above. So you cannot say that the pressure felt at the surface of the trough inside the capillary is just the atmospheric pressure, is just the pressure of mercury. It has to be the pressure of mercury column HROG plus the pressure of the vapors which are exerting on mercury on top of the mercury column. Since it is non-volatile, it will not evaporate, and that vapor pressure need not be taken into account. Being a metal, it is shiny, which allows for easier meniscus reading. Being a metal, it has low specific heat and is a good conductor of heat, which allows the mercury column to reach thermal equilibrium with the atmosphere more quickly. Its freezing point is much below zero, which allows us to use it at various temperatures. So the fact is that it is not going to freeze that easily. It has a very low freezing point, so you can use it even at very low temperatures, below zero. Had you used water, then below zero it would have solidified and you would not be able to use it. Its density is 13.6 times that of water, which allows the height of mercury column to be of reasonable length for reading atmospheric pressure. Water would need to have a height of 10.336 meters to read atmospheric pressure. This would make the use of barometer cumbersome. So now let's do another question. An open tank is filled with mercury up to a height of 76 centimeter. So this is the tank filled with mercury and the height is 76 centimeter. Find the pressure at the bottom of the tank and the middle of the tank and take atmospheric pressure to be 1 atmosphere. So remember, this is the first numerical question we are doing. So pause the video. Whenever a numerical question is given, try to think on your own. Remember, the purpose of all these videos is to enable you to think independently. So think on your own, whatever you get, however long it takes, doesn't matter. Think on your own. And it's only when you feel that you've exhausted all your attempts, and genuinely so, then go back and play the video. So now at the bottom and the middle, so let's say point A and point B. Now remember, this is 76 centimeter. Now the pressure of atmosphere in terms of mercury column is 76 centimeter. So 76 centimeter of mercury exerts the same pressure as the atmosphere. Now we are assuming the atmospheric pressure to be 1 atmosphere, which means that the 76 centimeter of mercury will also exert 1 atmosphere. Now in the middle, at point B, the pressure exerted by the particle will be the atmospheric pressure of 1 atmosphere and half the pressure of the entire mercury column, because it is right in the middle. So 76 centimeter is 1 atmosphere, remember. So external pressure is 1 atmosphere, and the pressure of half of the mercury column, half of 76 centimeter, is the one which is in addition to mercury column felt at point B. So the total will be 1.5 atmosphere. So that's because this guy is 1 atmosphere. And at point A, okay, let's get the point A first. I think it is easy. It is 2 atmosphere. You can easily see 1 atmosphere this one, 1 atmosphere this one, because 76 centimeter of HG is 1 atmosphere. And therefore, one atmosphere here, one atmosphere here, it is 2 atmospheres. And here it should be 1.5, this is 1 and this is 0.5, because if this is 1, the half of it would be 0.5 atmospheres. Alright, let's go for the next one. Two immiscible liquids of density rho 1 and rho 2 are filled according to the following diagram. It's not and filled, are filled. So this is the diagram. I've got liquid 1 and this is liquid 2. As you can see, they are different shades. So they're immiscible. Immiscible means they don't mix with each other. They don't dissolve into each other. They are separate into various layers like water and oil. So we have to, first of all, this is rho 1 and rho 2, densities are given. And this height is H1. This height is H2. Find the pressure at the bottom of the tank A. Find the pressure at the middle of the second layer B. So this is A, bottom. And remember, the next point B is middle of the second layer. This is second layer. So in between H2. Here. So now again, pause the video, try to get this on your own and then play the video back. So now let's figure out the pressure. First at A. Obviously, it will be H1 rho 1 G. This is the pressure of this column. And the pressure of this column is H2 rho 2 G. So, and that plus the atmospheric pressure. Do not forget the atmospheric pressure if the container is open. So pressure at A would be atmospheric pressure H1 rho 1 G, H2 rho 2 G. So based on that, tell me what is the pressure at B. Atmospheric pressure plus H1 rho 1 G plus H2 by 2 rho 2 G. So these are pretty simple questions, but they will definitely help you understand this lesson better. So that is the end of this video. This is part 1 titled Barometer and Manometer. It is the next part in which we will be doing gas laws. So that is part 2 of 13. And I hope you understood this video. You understood what was being taught here. If you have any questions, any doubts, any suggestions, any comments that you wish to make, please drop them in the comment section below. This is Kalyan Kumar signing off. Have a great day. Goodbye and thank you for watching.